Okay, so if we have 101 and 101, that is 5 plus 5, and that equals 10, which is 1010, so 8 plus 2. Now if we do that over here, we say 5 plus 5, and that equals A. All right, so you can see here with these two frankly ludicrous contraptions that are drawing probably around 2.5 amps total combined between the two, that we have two of possibly the dumbest calculators on the planet. But they were a lot of fun to build, and they taught me a massive amount about early computing and different theories behind how computing and calculators work. So what I want to do is create a series of videos that goes into a little more in-depth detail about both of these machines, about how I designed them, how I came up with them, how I cut them on the mill, and then ultimately how I debugged them and went through them, and about what, you know, each board does on both machines. But before we even get into the actual machines themselves, we can see that they're displaying something that's not easily readable for a human. This one in particular is displaying binary with just LED lights in a line. And so if you didn't have somebody to explain it to you, it might take a little while to figure out exactly what it is. In this one, you can see we did 5 plus 5, and we all know that 5 plus 5 equals 10, but it's actually displaying the letter A instead of 10. And that's because this one actually works on hexadecimal. Now, to understand exactly what hexadecimal is, exactly what binary is, exactly what decimal is, we kind of need to go in and do a little bit of refreshing on what kind of numeral and numbering systems that there are. And we can split them up into what they're based on by saying, you know, base 2, base 3, base 5, base 8, base 10, base 16. We can go all the way up to base 360. There's a ton of different types of numbering systems out there. The system that we're all most familiar with is base 10, which we can also just call decimal. This is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then when we go past 9 to the number 10, the first digit goes back to 0, and we carry a 1 over to the next digit. And this goes all the way up until 19, and then, you know, that 9 goes to 0 again, we carry a 1 into the next digit, which makes the next digit 2, and that's 20. That's base 10, that's decimal, that's what us as humans have become very accustomed to reading. But there's, in the computing world, there's very many different ways to display numbers. The king of all computing system numbers is binary. And so this is base 2. 0 and 1 are the only numbers in there. So we go 0, 1, and then when we go to, you know, the next number past that, the 1 circles back to 0, and we carry a 1 into the next digit. And then, you know, 0011 is 3, then 0100 is 4, and then 0101 is 5. So there's 0101. So that's our number 5 up here. Now you notice there's a bunch of LEDs up here. So this actually goes up to 10 bits. And 10 is quite a lot. That can go all the way up to, in decimal, that's all the way up to 1023. So this calculator can do addition and subtraction on two numbers, between 0 and 123, and then it displays the answer down here in binary. But you have to be very good at binary to be able to read an answer that large, because it requires a lot of mental math. But binary is not the only numbering system that has been used. There's also base 3, which is ternary. Now this one's really weird. It actually took me about 15 minutes of sitting down to try and wrap my head around it. Ternary is like binary, but there's just an extra digit. So 0, 1, 2. Now once you go 1 past 2, you go to 3, but instead of writing the number 3, the 2 circles back to 0, and we put a carry bit in the next digit. So 0010 is equal to 3, then 0011 is equal to 4, 0012 is equal to 5, and then 0020 is equal to 6. So it requires some kind of sideways thinking. But ternary is not unheard of in computing. As a matter of fact, in 1958, there was a ternary computer built at the Moscow State University. And there's actually a YouTuber that has a very cool channel, and he's building a homebrew ternary computer. His name's Dmitry Sokolov. So it's not an unheard of numbering system. Base 5 is quinary. This is essentially half of decimal, right? Because base 10 or base 5. So we count up to 5 essentially. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then to say 5, we go 1, 0. And then 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4. And then to say 10, we say 2, 0. So quinary, we don't really hear much about it, but it's actually been used in computing as well. The Facom 128B, which is a relay computer built by Fujitsu back in the 50s, it uses biquinary for its output. And that's a mixture of binary and quinary numbering systems. So it uses binary for part of it, and then, you know, quinary for another part of it. Now, moving up from base 5, we can get to base 8, which we can call octal. Again, like all the ones before us, we just count up to 8 and then we carry the digit over. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Instead of writing 8, we write 1, 0. And octal was actually pretty common in the early days of computing as well. Some of the massive mainframes, like the PDP-8 and the UNIVAC 1050, well, even the Apollo guidance computer, the computer that sent humans to the moon, it used octal in some regards. So moving on, we get up to base 16, which is hexadecimal. And that's actually what this calculator is using. And so hexadecimal is unique compared to the rest of these in that it actually uses numbers and letters. So just like all the other digits, you know, we count up 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then when we get to 10, instead of cycling around, you know, instead of taking that 9 and writing 0 and putting a 1 in the next digit, we represent 10 using a letter. So in this case, the letter A is 10. And then, you know, B is 11, C is 12, D is 13, E is 14, and F is 15. And then when we get to 16, you know, F, we've now hit are at the top of our base, we cycle that F back around to 0, we carry a 1 into the next digit, and that equals 1, 0. So 16 is 1, 0. And then 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 1, 6, 1, 7, 8, 1, 9, 1, A, 1, B, 1, C, 1, D, 1, E, 1, F. Now, hexadecimal is very, very common in modern computing for a couple of reasons, but most specifically in that you can represent 4 bits of data with just one digit, all right? So you can see that if we take, you know, A, which is 10, which in binary is 1010, we are representing those 4 digits of information in binary with just one digit for the human to read. All right, so hexadecimal is not exactly intuitive. It gets really confusing when you get up into larger numbers. I mean, you can see even here that 1/4 on hexadecimal is actually equal to the number 20 in decimal. So a lot of times you can see a hexadecimal address and you can go and you can get very confused because your brain is wired to reading and thinking about decimal. So the reason that I chose hexadecimal for this calculator is because I wanted to keep the display as minimal as possible, but on top of that, it's actually really difficult to go from 4 bits of binary to base 10 decimal. You can see that if you look here, that the number 10 is 1010. And in decimal, that's a good demarcation point. We go from one digit to two digits. But in binary, it's kind of in the middle. It's not the max of you know, 3 digits. It's not the max of 4 digits. It's in a really weird place. And that requires a lot of really unique logic gates and more complexity than I could have easily fit on a board this size to be able to do that. So by going to hexadecimal, it became a lot easier because 4 bits of data, which is what this operates on, it does 4 bits plus 4 bits or 4 bits minus 4 bits. That 4 bits of data can be represented entirely by one hexadecimal digit. All right, but I mean, you can see that on the display here, I have an extra digit here, and that's just to, you know, if we add, say, F plus F, that's 15 plus 15, that comes out to 30, which is 1E. So I need a place to display that extra carry that comes up here, and so that 1 that comes up there. So if we just do F plus F equals 1E. Now you notice that my carry digit showed up a little early there, and that's because there's some unique problems that I ran into with the design of this, and we'll go into that in a lot more detail in some future episodes. So that's the basics of the numbering system. You can see that I used binary on this one and I used hexadecimal on this one, but there's a lot of numbering systems that I could have gone with, and it just so happened that binary and hexadecimal are the most common. They're the most easily readable by humans outside of the decimal system that we've all become accustomed to. So next I want to kind of break these down into their individual components, take a look at how each board works, what the logic flow is between each board, and then, you know, ultimately why I made the design choices I made. And then we'll also look at some of the things that I got absolutely horribly wrong, and why there's still some problems that creep up in each of these.